الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل يا أيها الكافرون لا أعبد
In the name of God, most gracious, most merciful. Say, O you unbelievers, I worship not that which you worship, nor will you worship that which I worship. And I will not worship that which you have been wont to worship, nor will you worship that which I worship. To you be your way, and to me, mine. Bhakti, the Hindu devotional movement, originated in the Tamil-speaking regions of South India and swept across India like a lit fuse. Sufism, or Islamic mysticism, came as a part of Islam from West Asia. The fusion of these two movements, proclaiming human equality and divine grace, erupted in Varanasi in the person of the poet and radical reformer Kabir. Kabir's songs have been recited throughout North India for the last 450 years by pundits and illiterate tribals, wandering ascetics and classical singers, both Hindu and Muslim. Kabir was brought up in a Muslim weaver's family. To be a lowborn is a matter of pride, he says, for it is men of high rank who are strangers to divine grace. He attacked idolatry and declared God was nirgun, or without attributes. He is particularly scathing in his indictment of empty ritual. For me, the books of both religions are useless, he says.
संतों देखत जग बौराना सांच कहो तो मारन धावे झूठे जगपति आना
While his famous colleagues Tulsidas, Meera and Surdas address God in their songs, Kabir talks directly to us. His poems begin with friends or brother, sometimes ironically dear saints, or angrily listen imbecile. The intimacy, the irony, the roughness all show his passion to engage, to provoke, to shake people up.
Peter Pathar Pujan Lage, Tirath Garab Bhulana, Hindu Kahe Ohi Ram Pyara, Turk Kahe Rahimana, Aapas Mein Do Lari Lari Muhe Maram Na Kahu Jana, Kahani Kabir Suno Ho Santon, Isab Bharam Bhulana, Kaitik Kaho Kaha Nahi Mane, सहजे सहज समाना
मोक कहां ढूंढे रे बंदे मैं तो तेरे पास में
Many Hindus believe that death in Varanasi takes one to heaven. It is said that when the time of his death approached, Kabir left Varanasi and went to a village, which was considered an inauspicious place in which to die. This was his way of commenting on the superstition that sanctity of death is determined by geographical location. The earliest collection of Kabir's hymns is found in the Adi Granth, the sacred book of the Sikhs, which contains poems of 13 other saint poets, such as Namdev, Jaydev, and Hazrat Sheikh Fariduddin, more popularly known as Baba Farid. Baba Farid was the peer of Hazrat Khaja Nizamuddin Aulia. He wrote in the Multani dialect of Punjabi and is considered the father of Punjabi literature. In the Adi Granth, he is represented by 100 songs, which shows the esteem in which he was held by Guru Nanak. Kabir's Nirgun Bhakti movement reaches its climax in Nanak. I am neither Hindu nor Muslim, but a worshipper of the formless. Like Sufis, he considered everything other than God untrue. Nanak rejects asceticism and advocates a normal life accompanied by piety and righteousness. His belief that one should live by the sweat of one's brow can be traced back to Kabir as well as the Chishti saints. The century of Kabir and Nanak witnessed the development of a unique movement in Kashmir. The history of Kashmir has been shaped by its Sufis. But most of the Sufi orders there came into Kashmir from outside. At the beginning of the 15th century, there arose in the valley a Sufi order which was totally indigenous. It was founded by Sheikh Nuruddin, who called himself a Rishi, which in Sanskrit means an ascetic, and he drew his inspiration from a woman Bhakti saint. Laleshwari, known among Kashmiri Muslims as Lalla Arifa, was born in a Kashmiri Shaiva Brahmin family. Married early, she spurned family life and wandered around Kashmir, from village to village, singing songs in praise of a single formless divinity, condemning religious bigotry and intolerance. Her preaching set in train a new bhakti movement in the valley, which inspired the rishis. The rishis lived as ascetics and are remembered fondly for the fruit trees they planted wherever they went. Laleshwari and Sheikh Nuruddin wrote in the dialect spoken in their region and thus helped lay the foundations of Kashmiri literature. This was by no means unusual. In an effort to reach out to the masses, Sufis all over India wrote in the mother tongues of the people and created new literatures in languages which had no literary heritage, such as Awadhi, Bhojpuri, Braj, Bengali, and Punjabi. The Sufis of Karnataka, writing in Dakhni or Hindvi, composed songs specially for women to be sung while they performed their household chores, grinding flour, pounding grain, spinning the wheel or rocking the baby to sleep. It was about the same time that the newly evolving Hindi in the north brought forth its first Masnavi, or epic on the Persian model, Chandayan. But Mulla Dawood, the Sufi poet, turned his back on familiar Persian themes like Laila Majnu and chose a purely Indian folktale for his theme. In a Sufi poem, human passion becomes a symbol for man's love for God. The mystic yearns to have a glimpse of the supreme, but God remains forever beyond reach. The poems often end with the image of a person entering fire. This exemplifies the kind of new imagery which Indian themes opened up to Sufi poets. Self-immolation provides the perfect metaphor for fana, or the annihilation of the consciousness in the mystical union. The literary renaissance set in motion by Chandayan culminated more than a century later in Malik Muhammad Jaisi's Hindi epic Padmavat, which served as a model for the great Tulsidas himself. Though Sufis did not accept the Bhakti cults, many of them were fascinated by the deities, especially Krishna. A dictionary compiled in Persian to explain the terms in the Drupad says, Krishna and his other names indicate the perfect man. Murli or Basuri, that is the flute, indicates the appearance of existence out of void. Urdu poets Nazir Akbar Abadi and Maulana Hasrat Mohani wrote poems in praise of Krishna and other Hindu gods. Later Sufism emphasizes and venerates nearness to saints in terms of the saints' ultimate union with God. The tomb thus becomes a place of adoration. It is believed that the spiritual power of the saint, his barkat, survives death and is invested in his dargah or tomb. The dargah thus becomes a shrine which attracts devotees hoping to benefit from the saint's barkat. Many old traditions associated with the saints' khanqahs or monasteries continue to this day, the most important being the sharing of the food. At the Dargah Sharif of Hazrat Khaja Moinuddin in Ajmer are two huge cauldrons which are filled and cooked. The food is then distributed among the devotees. Akbar and Jahangir presented such cauldrons to the Dargah Sharif when they visited the shrine. Women are not normally permitted to pray in the mosques and thus find in the dargah a natural focus for the devotion. Often these tombs become identified with specific kinds of powers. Some shrines grant children, others are known for healing illnesses, physical or mental. Since the saint's death is seen as his final union with God, the occasion is celebrated as a joyful event and is commemorated annually as Urs. The resting place of the saint is decorated as a nuptial bed to prepare for the union of the saint with his beloved, God. The Urs of Hazrat Sayyid Banda Nawaz Gisu Daraz, a Chishti saint at Gulbarga, is one of the biggest in South India. Many of the devotees at the Urs are Hindus. Indeed, the Urs cannot even begin without the participation of local Hindu families. The large number of non-Muslims at a dargah underlines the fact that the dargah meets a real emotional need which cuts across religions. It also suggests why many Sufi saints succeeded in environments which were alien and often hostile. They took the human essence of Islam to the masses, bearing the delicate responsibility of dealing with each seeker at a personal level. At the moment of surrender in faith, the Sufi and the Bhakta become one. A poem of the Sufi Halaj begins, "I saw my Lord with the eye of my heart. I said, 'Who are you?' He answered, 'You.'"
سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم افتح لنا بالخير وارزقنا لنا بالخير واجعل باقي نورنا بالخير بيدك الخير انك على كل شيء قدير استحي يا الهي كل صعب بفضلك وبحرمتك سيد الابرار يا عبد يا سلام يا شافي يا كافي من كل امر سلام يا فتاح يا رزاق يا باسط يا الله يا خذ مني مثابه الجنه نسبه